Umbraco Forms offers a bunch of different features to help you create and customize your forms. My name is Isha, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to set up a simple form on Umbraco Cloud. So let's get started. This is my cloud project. To create a new form, we'll go to the Forms section and click on Create a Form. This is our Forms Design Editor. We'll start by giving our new form a name. I'll call it Contact Us. As you can see, a data consent field has already been added to our new form. To ask for data consent, we've made sure the question is already part of every new form created. It can be easily modified, copied, or deleted if that's what you prefer. I'll leave this in as it is. I'll give the page a name called Contact Us and the group Contact Details. We can add additional questions, groups, or pages to our form by clicking on the respective buttons. Let's go ahead and create our question. We'll do that by clicking on Add Question. The first thing I want in this form is a name. So I'll add it, and an alias is automatically generated for us. The help text here is something that will be displayed to explain to the user what they should fill out. Next up, we need to choose an answer type. There are different answer types here that are default with Umbraco Forms. I won't go into much detail about it. I'll leave the documentation link in the description below where you can find more information about these answer types. So for the name, I'll select short answer. After we've chosen the answer type, we are presented with some additional settings that we need to consider. To start off, we can set a default value and a placeholder value for the field. By default, the show label field is enabled to display the field's label while rendering the form. Next, we can enter the maximum number of characters entered in the field. From the field type dropdown, we can select the type of information expected. So, in this case, we expect a text. The autocomplete attribute allows the browser to predict the value when a user starts to type in the field. By default, the value is empty, but it can be set to on or off to have that value applied while rendering the form. We can mark the field as mandatory if the user needs to fill out the information to submit the form. So let's mark it as a mandatory field. You can also add a message that should be displayed when the mandatory field is empty. Finally, we can add some validation to the field and set some conditions. Currently, we don't need any of these for this field. Let's submit this question. And it's now added to the form design over here. We'll add the next question, and this one will be an email field. The answer type is going to be a short answer. The field type is email. It's a mandatory field. And let's add some validation to this field. There are some predefined validations here. So we'll select Validate as an email address and submit this field. Let's add the next question, and that is a message. For the answer, we'll choose long answer. And let's submit this field as it is. You might notice that this field doesn't have an asterisk. That's because we haven't marked the message field as a mandatory field. Moving on, the final question I want to add is phone number. We'll select short answer as its answer type. In the field type, we'll select number. We'll mark it as mandatory field. And we'll validate it as a number. And let's submit this question. At any point, if you wish to edit the fields that you've already added to your form, you can click on the cogwheel here. Cool. I think everything looks good, except for the data consent field on the top of my form. Let's say I want to reorder and move this field to the bottom of the form. I'll click on reorder up here, and now I have the option to move the fields around by simply dragging them. Once we are done reordering, we'll click on I'm done reordering up here at the top. Cool, this looks much better now. At the bottom of the form, we have a default workflow configured. So when you submit the form, it will either display a submit message or take you to another page and send an email to the email address defined here. Let's say I want to configure this workflow. To do so, I'll click on Configure Workflow. This dialog displays the workflow that will run once the form is submitted. So I'll click on Submit Message, and we have two options to choose from. For this video, I'll choose Message on Submit and just update the message to include Thank you for submitting the form. We will get back to you shortly. If you wish to display a specific page after the user has submitted the form, you can choose the page here. And now let's submit this option. The next option is to send an email template to an email address. So here you can either enable or disable the workflow, choose to include sensitive data in the email, choose an email template you wish to send after the form is submitted, add attachments if any, enter the different email addresses as required, and the subject of the email. To send emails from your Umbraco Cloud project, you need to configure the SMTP service in your appsettings.json file. For more information, you can look at the configuring SMTP settings on Umbraco Cloud video or look at our documentation. You'll find the documentation link in the description box below. Kindly note that Umbraco Cloud doesn't provide SMTP servers, so you'll need to find hosting elsewhere. For this video, I will not use this option, so I'll delete it and add another workflow. I'll click on Add Workflow, and we now have 10 workflow options to choose from. I'll select Slack and provide a workflow name and enter the webhook URL as well. You can find this information from your Slack channel. Let's submit this workflow. Now, let's take a quick look at the Settings tab. By default, all the submitted records are saved in the database. You can customize the labels of the Submit, Next, and Previous buttons used in your form. You can set a style sheet to give your form custom styling. Define a message that is displayed when a field is mandatory or when the value is invalid. You can choose to not mark any fields or change the indicator used when a field has been marked as mandatory. Add an autocomplete attribute value to control the overall form's autocompletion behavior. And finally, enabling the moderation feature allows the moderator to approve or deny a form before it's published. Now that we've taken a look at our form's design and settings, let's save the form. Our form is now ready and it's time to use it in the content pages. Let's say I want to add my form to the contact page. We'll go to the content section and select contact page. On this page, I have a contact intro property that uses a rich text editor as its editor. So I'll just remove this value from here and click on Insert Macro option. In this dialog, I'll select Insert Form with Theme. In Choose a Form, I'll click on Add and select Contactors. In Theme, I'll select the default Bootstrap 3 horizontal theme, and I'll enable exclude scripts so that it doesn't interfere with any scripts running on the page. Let's submit these changes and save and publish our node. Cool. We'll quickly go over to the template and verify if you're rendering the contact into a property. And here it is. Let's go ahead and look at our form on the front end. So our form is rendered here. I'll quickly add the details and be back. I've added in the form details. Now let's submit it. And there we have the submit message as configured in our form workflow. Let's go back to the back office and check if the form entry has been saved. So we'll click on Forms, Contact Us, Entries, and our entry is right here. Now, let's go to Slack and check if we have a message in there. And yes, we also have a message in here with the details from the Contact Us form. So, did you see how easy it is to get started with Umbraco Forms? Go ahead and play around with the different options Forms has to offer and include some easy or complex forms in your websites. I'll see you soon with another useful video. Until then, have fun with Umbraco Forms!